YouTubers, this is How Good Is Politics? I'm joined by Phil Coorey and Chris Uhlmann. This week we learnt that economic growth is quite slow. Phil, it grew by 0.5% to the June quarter, but the Treasurer says the economy is resilient. Is he right or are we in strife?
We don't know yet. Okay. Short answer. You know when you go to the RSL and they have Martin St. James, the hypnotist?
Yes.
Josh was like him this week, going, look into my eyes, there's nothing wrong here.
Nothing to see here.
Look ahead. That's what he has. So as we stand, or we sit here, the economy is in the worst shape it's been since the global financial crisis, but it is still in a lot better shape than a lot of other countries, right. So glass half full. But what the government is asking us to say, it is actually going to get better between now and Christmas because the tax cuts that they gave us on July 1 are going to supposedly stimulate all this activity.
And is that what it's all hinging on?
And cuts by the Reserve Bank and stuff. So yeah, interest rate cuts by the Reserve Bank. So we won't know till December whether they're right or not. And if it's still flat in December when we get our next set of numbers, then there might be a frisson of panic, I suspect.
Chris, is the government being overprotective of its surplus? Can it do more?
And people argue that it should be doing more to stimulate the economy. Certainly the Reserve Bank has been pointing in that direction. There is a lot of infrastructure spending going on, but the government has made such a big deal about reaching surplus, it's not going to sacrifice that now. I think once it does deliver a surplus, if things start to look a little worse, it might do something. But, you know, I think there is a reasonable argument to wait and see whether or not people, when they get those tax cuts, actually spend those tax cuts. But don't forget, there is another possibility that they might think that the world is a little bit uncertain and save that money. So we won't know how things are going to pan out until we actually see it.
The term consumption basically means how much we go out and spend every day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's 60% of the economy.
Yeah, more than half the economy. So if people are just, you know, saving dough, or rather than spending it, they're a bit nervous. You know, the thing we saw in the numbers on Wednesday was car sales have gone down the tube. Now, cars are a really big indicator of how confident people feel. You know, if you want to, you're thinking, oh, we need a new car, but it's a big, you know, it's a lot of dough, you know, 30, 40, 50 grand. So it's one of those things you think, oh, I'll just keep driving the other one for a couple more years because things are tight, and then car sales have gone down the toilet. So that's always an indicator that consumers aren't really feeling confident about going in and blowing money.
Yeah, look, interestingly, we're at a time when big geostrategic shifts are having an effect on the world economy. So we're seeing the trade war between China and the United States. We've got Brexit going on. There's an enormous amount of uncertainty, and it's based on the uncertain political circumstances. And, you know, if things go pear-shaped on that front, then anything is bad.
And we'll talk about Brexit in a minute, but I want to ask you about the federal police. They've been raiding in the capital again. Speculation is rife. They raided the home of an intelligence officer. Speculation's rife that this is somehow connected to previous raids on the home of a journalist and possibly the headquarters of the ABC.
Well, the Prime Minister said we shouldn't speculate about these things, so let's
speculate.
Exactly. So what do we know? We know that there are two sets of raids on the media. One of them was on the ABC, the other one was on a News Corporation journalist. Well, the one on the ABC, we know who gave that information out because the guy himself has said so. This former Defence Department official stood on the steps of the Supreme Court.
So can we scratch that off?
We can scratch the ABC one off. Yeah. So now we're down to
a sleuth-like process of elimination. Mm-hmm.
Indeed. Mm-hmm. Annika Smethurst's story. And her story was that the Australian Signals Directorate, which is only allowed to spy on people overseas, so even if you're an Australian, they can. They're the electronic eavesdropping organisation.
Provided you're overseas.
Right. They can look at you overseas. They can't look at you within the borders. Now, the story that she did said, well, they're thinking about the possibility of extending the remit of ASD. Cameron Gill, the person that was raided the other day, just so happens to be an Australian Signals Direct officer who used to work for the government in Mal Brough's organisation. So you might think we're getting a little bit closer to what might be happening there. The extraordinary thing, he's married to Australia's ambassador to Iraq, so it's a very Canberra story. It's a fascinating story. And you would think that the raid on News Corporation and the raid on Cameron Gill are the ones that are linked.
And Phil, Neil Gagan, in a parliamentary hearing, said that there was concerns about someone and their position in the bureaucracy over this.
Neil Gagan being the AFP commissioner.
Being the AFP deputy commissioner.
Yeah, I mean, put two and two together, you get four. But we won't know until they confirm it. If they confirm it, they're very secretive, not just the Australian Federal Police, but our whole security apparatus is becoming increasingly secretive and non-disclosive. So, but you know, until they tell us otherwise, we're free to speculate as much as we like. I did hear they're going to sponsor the Canberra Raiders. That's the joke going around town now. The AFP is going to replace Huawei as the new Raiders.
And they'll have a little,
like kicking indoors.
But they'll have it won't be an actual display on the jersey. They'll have to rip it off to see AFB.
Okay, let's talk about...
I stole that joke too from Robbo at SBS.
Robbo the cameraman from SBS, yep. It's a good one.
Full disclosure, I like the AFB. Yeah.
We could joke about this all day.
We were.
Okay, the Prime Minister and the Immigration Minister have stood firm over the deportation of a family of Tamil asylum seekers, a family that had made the small Queensland town Billawheeler home. There's been a strong outcry from the public over this. Everyone from Alan Jones, Barnaby Joyce, saying that this family should be allowed to stay. The Prime Minister and the Home Affairs Minister have said, no, nothing surprises me about their reaction to this.
No, they've been consistent. And they've been consistently hard. Like any single one of these stories that you take, and there are literally thousands of them, will be a very emotional story. And I can perfectly understand why the people of Billawheeler would want to support this family and why they've gathered a lot of support around Australia. I can also perfectly understand that the federal government is going to maintain what has been its hard line consistently. The problem is, for the Labor Party, it seems to bounce backwards and forwards between wanting to appear to be hard and wanting to appear to be compassionate. Now, unfortunately, I think that puts them in a more awkward position than the government. The government just looks hard. It always looks hard.
Yeah.
The Labor Party looks utterly inconsistent.
Yeah, what do you think of Labor's response here, Phil?
I'm not as harsh as my colleague here. I don't know what to think, to be honest. This one surprises me because generally the majority of Australian voters are completely unsympathetic towards asylum seekers, especially those who are found not to be valid and have no right to stay. And I find it really interesting that this one is a real 50-50 type thing out there in the public. I think maybe because there's a face to the name. And, why are we seeing people like Alan Jones? Well, Alan Jones may be trying to just curry favour with, advertisers again. I don't know. But people like Barnaby Joyce and so forth, it's odd that they're coming out. They're being counterintuitively in support. Maybe there's there's a humanity out there that we haven't seen before. But I agree with Chris, the government pretty much has no choice. But I do notice that both Morrison and Dutton the last week have said every occasion, if you just go back home and you apply to come here as a migrant, nudge, nudge, wink, wink, you'll probably get let in. So they're also sensitive to the, their language hasn't been as harsh as it has in the past towards these sorts of cases.
Okay, well, let's jump out of our lane a little bit now.
Awesome.
We'll talk about Brexit. I prefer the slow lane, anyway. Talk about Brexit. And I reckon that Scott Morrison hit the nail on the head this week when he said that Boris Johnson's dealing with a bag full of angry cats. How do you see this playing out from here, Chris?
Well, it's been extraordinary to watch. The thing about parliamentary systems is they have a genius for sorting out problems. And of course, the UK is home to our parliamentary system, the one that we all understand. They're now showing the limits of their unwritten constitution. They have boxed themselves into a position, particularly since now they have fixed terms elections, where the executive wants to call an election and can't because the parliament's ruled against that. The parliament can't come to a conclusion. All it knows is it doesn't want to crash out of the EU. So it is literally the intractable circumstance. I don't know how it sorts itself. I fear that whatever happens in the UK, this will end in violence. That we will see violence on the streets of the United Kingdom because the passions there are so high that one side ends up losing this. One side does end up losing. So I really hope that they can find a way through that avoids clashes in the streets of London.
Look, Boris Johnson is a fool. He's only got himself to blame. I mean, him and people like Nigel Farage, they led the push in the UK, however many years ago it was, now it seems like forever, for Brexit. But it was just a populist move with no detail, right? So it was easy, and so everyone voted for it because basically because it was a backlash against open borders in the EU, not much more than that. It was a sovereignty issue. But there was no model for Brexit. There was no detail about how they were going to do it. It was just this populist vote. As soon as it passed, the two people who led it, Farage and Johnson, just like utter cowards, vacated the political scene. So Britain just has wallowed for the last few years. He's now come back in as the Prime Minister after destabilising Theresa May for all these years and not allowing her to come up with a solution. and now I think sucked in. I think it's just landed on his lap.
Yeah, but I don't think the European Union should get off scot-free. I mean, what happened with the European was this endless expansion of powers at the expense of nation states.
Yeah, but
and in the end, the organisation gets so big and so removed from people. If you had a vote in the Netherlands, or if you had a vote in Spain, or if you had a vote in France, you'd find it go pretty close to people wanting to get out.
It's Britain's decision how they leave. It's not the EU.
I understand
that.
The EU's saying, fine, go and leave. When these, and there've been a lot of frictions over a lot of years with people saying this thing is getting too big and too out of control, and they and their argument always was ever greater union, and we've seen right across the EU.
But this, my criticism is not of, I'm not supporting the EU here. Yeah. My criticism of this complete lack of process in the UK for getting out of there because the people who drove it had no idea how to deliver.
And all I'm saying is,
and now it's come back.
Won't be the last place where this becomes an issue, and the European Union, as it continues to expand its remit, will come up against bigger and bigger problems. One day the euro will tear itself apart because you can't have a monetary system that doesn't have a single fiscal system, but they don't have that at the moment.
Well, all I can say is the British must have a really good public service because there has been no government in that country now.
That's a really good point, for two years.
Yeah. No functioning government. And I assume the civil service has been, because the economy is still going quite well and all else. Their defence forces and so forth. So, hats off to the public servants of Britain because their government's an utter joke and their opposition's an even bigger joke. And it's, I feel really sorry for the people of Britain because, there's no clear end in sight.
No, and an election won't resolve this. So what you can see happening is that no one will have a majority in the next parliament because Jeremy Corbyn can't make up his mind what he wants to do. What does the Labour Party stand for?
And people in the UK, my brother lives there, are, as he says, starting to stockpile supplies. Like, this is no joke. Like, this is a genuinely scary prospect. Disturbing news out of number 10 Downing Street. Boris Johnson's dog is moving in, at least for the time being.
Little Labrador?
I believe so, yeah. Something like that.
Well, the owner and their pet look the same.
A Labradoodle.
A golden retriever, wouldn't it?
Let's leave that one up to our viewers to decide. What does this mean for poor old Larry the cat?
I don't think Larry's going to have to worry too long. The dog's not going to be there very long. I wouldn't get comfy if I was Bobo.
Bobo.
I agree.
Sources say Larry's not happy, Phil.
Well, it wouldn't be, would it? But I'm with Uhlmann on this one. I wouldn't be making plans yet to leave.
Right.
Larry, if I was the cat.
Yeah. Just move up to the attic for a while, buddy. Yeah. You'll be right.
Next.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us on How Good Is Politics?
Hi, YouTubers. I'm Davina Smith. Well, click here to keep watching great Nine videos and subscribe to our channel here for lots more news, analysis and exclusive content. For breaking news, see you at 9news.com.au.